Psalm 1. Do you have your Bible with you? You have a Bible with you? I'm just curious. Not asking for a raise of hands, but I hope you've got a Bible. We're going to talk about the Bible from the Bible today. Okay, in fact, probably preach a few sermons that if you want to put it under a large umbrella category name, we'll just call it You and Your Bible. You and Your Bible. Now, I think if we're honest, and we ought to be because we're in church, right? Try that from time to time in church, be honest. We'd have to say that this book is probably one of those things that we find ourselves taking for granted all too often. Can we be honest about that? Would you agree with me about that? I do. You say, Mick, you're a pastor, and you take the Bible for granted? Yes, I do. I admit it. I admit it. In the world today, it's estimated that close to 3 billion people do not have access to a gospel witness. They don't know about Jesus. They don't know the good news. That's 40% of the world's population. Think of that. 40% of this world's population does not know what it means or how to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That's a devastating statistic. Did you know that in 52 countries around the world, the Bible is 100% banned? You cannot have a copy of the Bible. If you do, you face the penalty, which could be death. 200 million around the world have zero Bible in their language. 200 million people, not a word of the Bible in their language. In my office, I counted, I have 13 hard copies of the Bible in various translations. In my Logos Bible software, I have nearly 300 iterations of the scripture at my fingertips digitally. Some 35 different translations of the Bible that I can access on any device. And I take it for granted. Some of you have Bibles sitting around at home that you didn't realize you had. Maybe they're holding something else up. Maybe they're tucked behind those paperbacks that you've read 4 or 5 times. Most of us have a copy of the Bible on our phone. Easy for us to take for granted our access to the Scripture. And so, in the next few weeks, as we talk about you and your Bible, I want us to gain an appreciation for the fact that you and I this morning have God's Word in our laps or in our hands, and we can open it and read it and study it and preach it and teach it and share it freely. Psalm 1 is the text. This sermon's entitled, You and Your Bible. Objective, contingency, and outcome. Here's what the psalmist says, beginning in verse 1 of Psalm 1. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight, here it is in the law of the Lord. And on his law he meditates day and night. I'm challenged by that already. It's convicting already. The psalmist continues, he's like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, the Bible says he prospers. On the other hand, the wicked are not so, verse 4, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Objective, contingency, and outcome. Here's the objective. It's very simple. It's stated right in the first verse. The objective is blessed living. Blessed living. You say, Mick, what does it mean to live blessed? We use that term blessed, right? God bless you, like when you sneeze. I used to think it was just a sneezing term. You sneeze, oh, bless you. Okay, I don't know what that means, but thank you. Right? We talk about blessing others. It's kind of one of those Christianese terms that maybe we say a lot, but maybe we really don't understand exactly what it means. The meaning is pretty simple, honestly. To be blessed is to be happy. So blessed living is happy living. It's life in a general state of well-being. This phrase, as we read it in Psalm 1, literally is an exclamation, and it's sort of congratulatory in its nature, like, hail to the man who is blessed. Or, oh, the blessedness, oh, the happiness, oh, the joyfulness. Or, oh, how well he lives. This is what the psalmist is saying. The blessed man, and blessing is the objective, is a happy man. He is a joyful man. Now, maybe not happiness in the way that you're thinking of happiness, because this happiness that is being spoken of, this blessedness, is less pursued than it is bestowed. In other words, we pursue happiness in a lot of different things, right? Like, if you're an Illinois football fan yesterday, you were happy. If you're a Northern Illinois fan, you're in disbelief and you're happy. Or maybe you had your favorite meal over the course of the weekend and it made you happy. Maybe you got a raise at work and you're happy about that. Maybe vacation was great, it made you happy. There's all kinds of things that make us happy. Maybe you got a new vehicle and there's a happiness associated with it. I don't know what it is for you, but there are all kinds of things that we pursue in an effort to be happy. Wealth, relationships, popularity, stuff. But blessing and happiness that is bestowed is what results from the vital relationship that we have with God and His Word. That's the blessedness. That's the happiness that the psalmist is speaking about. Now, let me suggest just a few characteristics of what it means to be blessed or happy. First, it means this. It means you're secure in your saving faith. Isn't it a blessing to know that no matter what has happened in my life, no matter what I have done, no matter where I have been, no matter how wicked my past might be or how dark the chapters are that I have lived in the past, the blood of Jesus Christ is powerful enough to save me and wash me white from my sin. Amen. Isn't that a joy-giving promise from God's Word? And I can be happy and blessed and secure in the promise that in spite of my sinfulness, Jesus Christ paid the price with His blood, and I can enjoy relationship with Him, and I can enjoy the imputed righteousness of Christ that is put into my account as He takes my sin on Himself. That's a blessed thing. If we live a blessed life, we are secure in our saving faith. If we live a blessed life, we are victorious in the ongoing battle with our sinful tendencies. Now, I'm not saying you live perfectly. I'm not saying you never sin again, but guess what? One of the things that happened when Jesus died on the cross and you placed faith and trust in him is that he has freed you from the temptation that dogs you and from your compulsion to sin. Now, we may still be tempted, we may still choose to sin, but we don't have to. He has freed us from that. We don't have to be the loser, we can be the winner. That's blessing. A third characteristic might be fulfillment. Does your life and the way you live your life, does that fulfill you? You want to know a simple way that you can live a life that's fulfilled? Live it for the kingdom. Don't live for the temporary. Don't live for the here and now. Don't live for the shiny things that are out there in front of you. Don't live for all the world tells you is going to make you happy. Live for the kingdom. Live for Jesus. Live for things that are eternal. We're going to be with Jesus forever. We're here maybe 70, 80 years. Or if you're JR, maybe a little longer than that. He's 18 again next year. That's just another year he's adding to the end, right? But we'll be with Jesus forever. Why don't we live for that? Blessing in life and fulfillment in life comes when we live on kingdom mission, doing the will of God, making disciples as he's commanded, serving him and praising him and pointing others to him. That's blessed living. And then a final characteristic, and certainly this is an exhaustive list, but living a blessed life does not always mean that things are easy. But what it does mean is that we can have joy even in the face of hard things. Some of you are going through some hard stuff. Some of you have experienced great loss. Some of you are grieving. Some of you are on the verge of depression. Some of you feel a little bit hopeless from time to time. Maybe the job's not what you wish it was. Maybe you don't have enough money to pay the bills. Maybe you've lost somebody close to you, somebody near and dear, and you miss the relationship. Maybe there are relational struggles in your family. I don't know what it is. It may not equate to your happiness in the moment, but it does not have to steal your joy. As a blessed man, as someone who's placed faith and trust in Jesus Christ, even in the hard things, I can experience joy because my joy, as we've said so many times before, is not tethered to my circumstance. It's tethered to my relationship with Jesus. So blessed living is the objective. You say, Mick, what does that have to do with the Bible? Well, I'm about to show you. Because while blessed living is the objective, I want to talk about the contingency next. What does it hinge on? Living a life of blessing or not, what is the factor that determines which? Let me just tell you, the Bible tells us what it is. Look at what the scripture says. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scoffers. Here it is, verse 2. Black and white, right here. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. That's the contingency. You want to live life as a blessed person? Here's what it's contingent on. It's contingent on your delight. What are you delighting in as a person? You say, Mick, what does it mean to delight? Again, more language I never use. It was such a delightful game. No, we don't say that. The coffee this morning was delightful. That's not how we like it. We like it fork tender, robust with French vanilla cream. It's not delightful. It's good. We need it. I don't use the word delight very often, but the scripture uses it here. So what does it mean? To delight in something is to value it. to take pleasure in it, to derive satisfaction from it. So I delight, I value it, I delight, I am pleasured by it, I am satisfied with it. Now, such value and pleasure and satisfaction, these are not things to be contrived. In other words, we can't, like, manufacture it. Don't manufacture delight. Rather, they must be received. We must ask God, as John Piper so eloquently put it, to put new taste buds on the tongue of our hearts so that we have a taste for His Word, so that we can delight in it. Because let's be honest, the Bible is not something that we naturally delight in. Say, well, I do. I'm super spiritual. Okay, well, the rest of us don't. Thanks for blowing the curve. You say, well, why don't we delight in it? Well, because reading and study are work. I don't know if you've noticed this or not. We got a few nerds in here that just totally love school and education. I'm not one of them. I don't think I read a book from cover to cover until I was an adult. I'll admit that. Right? I didn't enjoy studying. The academic part of college for me was just, why am I here? Oh, yeah, Jill's here. That's why I was there. I'll own it. Now, I've since gone back to school and gotten some higher education. I do enjoy reading. Okay, but it wasn't something that came naturally to me, and it probably doesn't come natural to you because it's a lot of work to study. It's a lot of work to read, especially if you're reading a translation of the Bible that's a little more archaic. I'm not here to bash any translation or any of that, but some of the translations that are in older English are hard for us to understand. I get that. Get you a translation you can understand. But reading and study are hard work. And then interpreting and understanding are exercise. Ugh, the E word. Some of you love exercise. Again, I don't think I need to say how I feel about exercise. I think that's clear to everybody, right? But understanding what the Word of God says and interpreting, that takes work too, and it's exercise to do that. So again, it doesn't come naturally. The exercise in the light of God's Word is not something that necessarily comes naturally to us at all. Both the desire to be in God's Word and the delight that comes from God's Word, the hunger and the satisfaction alike that we feel around the Word of God come from God Himself. He gives that to us. And so if you're struggling with your delight in God's Word, maybe you simply need to pray and say, God, I need you to change my taste buds. I need to acquire a taste. I need to be diligent. I need your power in my life to help me to study, help me to read, help me to understand so that I can delight in your word. And once we receive that, and once God begins to give us a taste for his word and a delight in his word, that delight must be nurtured. Look what the psalmist says. Again, he says, his delight, the blessed man's delight is in the law of the Lord. Okay, so he has the taste. God has given him the taste for it. And look what he says after that. And on his law, he meditates day and night. He nurtures the delight. That word meditate literally means to murmur. In other words, he walks around all day muttering the scripture to himself. Now, I'm not saying that that should be a habit that we should form, okay? You walk around muttering about other things, so I don't know why you wouldn't, but, okay, it's not something we'd necessarily do. And here's why it happened the way it happened back in the day that the Psalms were written. They didn't have a written copy of God's Word laying around on every coffee table in every house. They had some tablets, they had a few scrolls. Not everybody had a personal copy, and much of what we know in the scripture that's written down for us now was passed on word of mouth, generation to generation, and so they would literally memorize these things. And they would literally walk around and mutter these things and repeat these things. This is how they meditated. This is how they thought about it. Now, our meditation in today's world might be different. It might look different. When people ask me, and I get asked this a lot, Mick, where do I start when it comes to Bible reading? How do I begin to study my Bible? I don't say, hey, start at the beginning and just, why don't you sit down and in four or five sittings, just read through the whole thing once and then we'll get back together. We know how far that gets, right? Leviticus, peace out. No, what I will tell people is, hey, find a passage of scripture, and a lot of times I'll refer people to the Gospels or to the epistles, and I'll say, here's what I would do for the first several days. Read a few verses, just a few, and maybe jot a thought down, and then think about those things that you're reading all through the day. Maybe one or two thoughts, and that's it. And then the next day, guess what? Read the same verses, and think about it, and chew on it. Meditate on it. Think about it. This is how we nurture the delight. Now, is there anything wrong with reading through the Bible in a year, cover to cover, or in 2 or 3 weeks? No, go for it. We ought to. But it shouldn't just be a rote exercise. We nurture the delight by meditating on what the words of the scripture are saying to us day in and day out, morning and evening. They should be a priority. I know you struggle with this. I do too. So why is that? Why do we struggle? Can I suggest a couple of things? I think we struggle first because we fill our hearts and our minds and our calendars and our agendas full of things we perceive to be more important than God's word. We do. Never in history have people been more busy than they are now. It's a rat race, you know it is. And you know how easily distracted we are. And so we leave no time for spiritual efforts, and that's part of the problem, is we kind of say, well, you know, I got a lot of things to do today, a lot of people I need to talk to, places I need to go, people I need to see, emails I need to respond to, I'm busy at work, the kids have sports, I'm here, there, and I'm everywhere. If I have a minute at the end of the day, I will sit down and read God's word. Guess what? It never happens, right? There's a principle in the Bible, the principle we call is the principle of first fruits. So when people would harvest, before they did anything else with what they harvested, they took the first fruits to the temple. They worshiped with their first fruits. What if we decided that no matter how busy our schedule was and how many people needed us to respond to them, that we were going to give the first fruits of every single day to God? And in some place undistracted, we would sit down and we would read and we would find something that we could meditate on through the day. What if we did that? Would that not revolutionize your life? You say, I don't know, would it? Yes, it would. Guarantee. I struggle with this as a pastor. But you know what I found? I find that if I get up early in the morning and my biological makeup is making this easier for me as I get older, I'm up for another reason, so I just stay up. I get up and I go make a cup of coffee and then I go and I sit on the porch. And it's typically dark, but I have an app on my phone called Dwell. I've mentioned this already. You should get the app. I think there's a small charge for it, but you should get it. And I can put it on and it will read the scripture to me. And there's a little ambient music playing in the back, but no other distraction. I don't pick up my phone. I don't scroll. I don't check emails. I simply listen to God's word And sometimes if it's light enough in the morning, I'll read along. I have to have that. Do I have other things I could do? Yeah. There are things Jill wants me to do. I did find my workbench in the garage this week, so I feel very accomplished. My biggest fear was that since Jill had enough energy this last week to clean Parker's room, my garage was going to be next. So I thought, I just need to do this. I need to head this off at the pass. So do I have stuff to do? Yeah. Are there emails I need to respond to? Of course. Is there stuff that's flooding my mind about things here at church and people in this church and stuff happening with the building and all that? Of course there is. I need to quiet myself and spend my time with God first fruits. We struggle because our lives are full of everything else. Maybe we struggle because when we read, we are reading in search of something instead of reading in search of someone. Right? You ever do this? Man, I'm struggling. I got a specific problem. I know the Bible says something about it. Oh yeah, way in the back. What's that? Topical. I need a verse for my situation. It's like I have a headache, so I take a pain reliever. I've got a problem in life, so I got to find something in the Bible. Or maybe so-and-so's got a problem, and I've got to find a Bible weapon I can use on them. All right, this is what we do. We look for things. I need something from God's Word. Or maybe that's the approach generally. I don't read the Bible because I don't get anything out of it. Well, maybe you need to stop focusing on the thing and start focusing on the who. Do you realize that the Bible is one big story? It's what we call a meta-narrative. And it is the story of God. This is how God, in part, has revealed himself to us in his book. You want to know God? Get into the Bible. Now, is it useful when I'm struggling with things? Is there encouragement for me to find, or is there a command for me to follow? Of course. But ultimately, it's not about what, it's about who. And so we struggle sometimes because the only time we'll go to the Bible is when we're trying to find something. Why don't you try pursuing someone by reading your Bible? Another reason we struggle is that a lot of times we'll take a multitasker approach. Kind of talked about this already, right? We fail to employ the discipline of solitude. We don't practice much of that, right? Solitude, you know what that is? Kind of by yourself, quiet, no distractions. Deer season's coming up. I'm a hunter. You may like that, you may not. I'm not here to argue that with you. Don't email me about that either, please, but here's what I do love about hunting season. I love getting in the tree stand and it's just me. There's a solitude about it. And I'm taking in the sights and the smells, and I feel the breeze, and I think about, man, what creative genius was employed in the making of all of this. And when I get up in the morning and I grab my coffee and I head to the porch, it's just me. Just me with God. Just me with God's Word. We need the solitude. Now, like I said, with that app, I can't listen to what Scripture is being read and scroll and answer emails at the same time. Guess where my focus goes? Straight to the emails. By the way, let me just say this. Okay, I'm just going to get on a soapbox for a second. If you don't have a hard copy of the Bible, you need to get one. I'm not against technology. I'm really not. In fact, you can come in and click on the e-bulletin and click on a button, and it'll take you to a text online so that you can follow along, and that's useful. I'm not saying it's not. But you want solitude, you want to be undistracted when you read God's word, get you a hard copy of the Bible. When I study for sermons, I have this software, it's called Logos. Some of you have it. It's amazing. There are literally, I bet I have 60,000 volumes in my library on Logos. I've read one of them, but I have 60,000. And it's a great tool, and I can go online, and I can find facts, and I can, all this stuff. It's an amazing tool, but what I need and where I need to start when I'm starting to put together the meal for the flock on Sunday mornings is with this book, just the book. I don't even have a study Bible that I look at first. I just want to know what the text says. I don't want to be distracted by anything else. I cannot multitask. Our time with God should not be multitasking time. So the objective is to be blessed in our living. The contingency is the delight that we take in God's word. And here's the last thought for the morning. The outcomes. What happens? What happens when the word of God becomes my delight? The psalmist speaks to that. Look at that again in verse 3. He's like a tree that's planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season. And its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. That's the outcome. Isn't that an outcome that sounds appealing to you? It sounds appealing to me. I think we can break it up into three categories, kind of like he does. The man who delights in the word of God, the woman who delights in the word of God, the blessed life of a person delighting in God's word will result in nourishment, fruitfulness, and prosperity. Now, let's break those down quickly. Let me ask you this question out of the gate. Think about this. Are you thriving spiritually? Or are your leaves a little bit withered this morning? Are you thriving spiritually, or are you withering on the vine? Are you withering on the branches? Do you feel dead spiritually? You ever feel dead spiritually? Like nothing's happening, like no pulse, like no activity? I think we all go through seasons and periods of dryness like that. The blessed man who delights in God's word is well nourished. The Bible says he's like a tree that's planted by a stream of water. Here's the picture. I know you're thinking of this pastoral setting, big, beautiful oak tree with roots that are kind of creeping down into the stream that's trickling by. I think that's the painting that we usually see. What this is actually referring to is a man-made irrigation ditch. And what they would do is they would plant their fruit trees and plant their nut trees right along the banks of the irrigation ditch. And so those trees would be well nourished. They would be well watered. Listen, nourishing leads to flourishing. Say, Mick, I'm struggling. I don't flourish. I don't feel like I'm flourishing spiritually. I don't feel like I'm flourishing in my relationships. It's because you're not well nourished. You need the nourishment. You need the sweet, nourishing, cool waters that are flowing in an irrigation ditch that God has dug himself, his word. And if you will get your roots down deep in that and be nourished by this, you will find yourself flourishing in life. That's the principle. Nourishment, that's an outcome. Vitality, life. Fruitfulness, proximity to the river of God's word cannot be disconnected from fruitfulness. You say, Mick, what fruit am I to be producing? Well, there's some obvious ones, right? The fruit of the Spirit, we read about that in Galatians 5. Write that down. Read it this afternoon. The fruit of the Spirit is, and there's a whole list of them. Study it out. The fruit of the Spirit is born in our lives when we are well nourished, when the roots of the tree that we are deep into the waters of the river that this book is. The fruit of the life of godliness, 2 Peter 1, we've preached that before. Look it up again this afternoon. God has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. This is what Peter says. And we add a bunch of things to our faith, virtue, knowledge. We are flourishing because we are nourished by God's word. If you want fruit on your branches, you better get your roots into this book. The fruit starts with the root. And your roots need to be in the river. What about prosperity? Say, Mick, oh, you one of those prosperity theologians? Well, I kind of am, but not how you're thinking. I don't have a private jet. I asked Kenneth Copeland if I could have one of his, and he didn't get back to me. I don't drive a fancy car. I don't have a fancy house. I don't have a lot of money in the bank. I think by the world standards, people might look at me and say, well, you're just not really very prosperous. And maybe by the world standards, I'm not. Actually, the truth of it is, by the world standards, we're all probably in the top 1%. But by our culture, our society standards, maybe we're not prosperous. I don't know. I don't really care, to be honest. The psalmist isn't talking about prosperity in the sense of health and wealth. But what he's speaking of is prosperity in the sense that your kingdom work succeeds and accomplishes the divine purpose that God intends for it. Now, there I want to be prosperous. There I want to preach prosperity. It is a prosperity gospel from that standpoint, because what God has given me, the good news that has saved me from my sin, I can take and put to work for His glory and for His kingdom and for the salvation of others, and He will prosper us all. The psalmist, again, in Psalm 90 in verse 17 says this, "Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us." I think we would all say, yeah, that sounds like a great idea. Could we have God's favor on us? Can we live in the favor of God? Of course we want that. I believe we have that at the pasture. I hope you have that personally in your life. Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us. And here's what he says after that. And establish the work of our hands upon us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. What does that mean? Doesn't mean that I'm scrapping and scraping and climbing and doing all I can to try to get all I can and get the gusto and climb to the top of the corporate ladder and gain all this stuff for myself and just indulge in all the world has to offer. That's not what it's talking about. What it's talking about is when I yield and humbly serve the King of Kings and do what I ask, what He asks that I would do. And when I step into the opportunities that He puts in front of me to serve Him and to share Him with other people, He will bless that work. He will prosper that work. See, the thing is that anything that you and I can do, you know, we can't save each other, right? I can't save you from your sin. I can't fix your issues. I can't solve your problems. I can't heal your brokenness. I can't heal your physical body. But God can, and He wants to use me to do it. And so when I obey Him and do the ministry that He has given me to do, prosperity says, God establishes the work. That's prosperity. And that is what it means to live a blessed life. The contingency is, of course, our delight in this book. So here's the simple challenge for you. If you're reading and studying, continue to dive deeper. Continue to know your God better. But if, sadly to say, you're in the majority of us in this room this morning, who struggle to take delight in this book because it's work, because it's exercise, let me just encourage you to take one step forward. Open to the Gospel of John when you get home today and just read a few verses. Open to one of the Pauline epistles, maybe Romans, because it talks so much about the gospel, and read a few verses. Write something down. Put it on a sticky note on your mirror or on the visor in your car and meditate on it. And get up tomorrow morning, and before you do anything else, read the verses again and write something else down. And meditate on it and chew on it. And do it again the next day and the next day and the next day and the next day. And before you know it, you will have developed a holy habit. And when a day comes and you're tempted to get about the business of the day, you've got so much to do, you won't be able to go past your time with God and His Word. You will be delighting. It's what we need. We cannot be followers of Jesus and ignore this book. We cannot be a church that's on the move for God and ignore this book. You can be religious and ignore this book, but we're not about religion. We're about relationship with Jesus, and that requires us to delight in this book.